So good morning, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Good morning, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Sir. Sir, I'm audible to you, sir.
Yeah, you are audible, sir. I think maybe I can see my video not coming. 1 minute, sir. I stop share the. Oh, sorry. Okay. Yeah. It's okay, sir. Now it's okay. Thank you. Yeah, I think my video is okay. Not coming, sir. Yeah, I click the start video, but it's not coming. It's okay, sir. I think we can. Is it audible? I'm audible to all of
Hello.
You.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Yeah, I'm audible, sir. Hello.
Sir, can you switch on the video?
Yeah, actually, video is not working, sir. But am I audible? Okay, thank you. I think I'm starting my video, but I think there's some issue. It's not working. It's okay, sir. I think we can proceed without the video. Yeah. Yes, sir. We'll proceed without the video, sir. I think there is some issue here with me. Yeah. Okay, sir. Okay, I think some issue with the here, sir, with my network. I think my apologies. The video is not working here, although I'm clicking it on. We can proceed, sir. We can start and proceed. Hello, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir, sir. Actually, my.
Hello.
Yeah, is it audible, sir? My voice is audible? No?
I request all the participants to please wait for a few minutes. Due to some technical issues, it is taking some time. So it's my kind request. Yeah. Please, all of you, please wait.
My voice is audible, sir. Yeah, there are some issues with the video, sir. Maybe if my voice is audible, I think we can start. I can share the presentation and we can start, sir. Yeah. Is it okay, sir?
Hello. Hello.
Yeah, I can hear you, sir. I can hear
yes,
you.
Yes, sir. Your voice is audible, sir, now. Yes, sir. Sir, your video is not possible, sir. Your video is not possible, sir.
Yeah, there are some. I think I'm clicking the start video, but it is not giving me the access. It's okay, no problem, sir. We can start.
Okay, sir. Let me. I will just give you a brief introduction about you. Then after that, you can start your presentation, sir.
Okay.
A warm welcome to all the participants on the third day of the ITIL FTP. So let me introduce our professor on this occasion, Dr. TVVLN Rao. He's presently working as a research associate professor in SRM Institute of Science and Technology, Chennai. Today, sir is going to present on a topic titled Hydrodynamic and Squeeze Film Analysis of Partial Slip Texture and Surface Porous Layer Configurations in Bearing. Let me give you a brief introduction about our professor, TVVLN Rao. Sir has received PhD in Tribology of Fluid Film Bearings from IIT Delhi in 2000 and M.Tech in Mechanical Manufacturing Technology from NIT Calicut in 1994. Sir's current research interests are in bearings, lubrication, and tribology, and he has authored over 120 publications till date. He has secured several research grants from the Ministry of Higher Education, Malaysia, and research grant from the Sumitomo Foundation, Japan. He is also a member of Society of Tribologists and Lubrication Engineers, Malaysian Tribology Society, and Tribology Society of India. He is a member of organizing committee of Third Malaysian International Tribology Conference, which will take place in Malaysia during 5th to 7th July 2021. Currently, Sir is working as a research professor in Department of Mechanical Engineering at SRM Institute of Science and Technology since 2017. A warm welcome you, sir, once again. Sir, you can start your presentation. Mic over to you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Raghuvanshi, sir.
Thank you very much, sir.
For your kind introduction and very, very good morning. Good morning, and welcome to all the participants to this webinar. A bit of apologies from my side also that the video is not working, but however, I will try to share the information. So thank you so much. In fact, this has been very difficult times for going on for quite long, and all of you have been very kind in terms of participating in these webinars in spite of your very busy schedule. I would like to thank Geetham, indeed honored to be on this platform today as a part of this AICTE ATAL Faculty Development Program. It's indeed an honor for us. And we would like to thank Geetham, Mechanical Engineering Head of the Department, Professor Nageswara Garu, and our friends, Dr. Ashok, Dr. Rashekar, Dr. Raghuvanshi. We thank you so much. With this, without further delay, I would like to start my presentation. I would like to share the screen. Well, so going back, I am going into the slideshow mode. Well, thank you so much. I know that many of our participants over here are experts in tribology. Some of them are working in the area of tribology related areas. But this is more of fluid film lubrication. And I'm sure that many of you are also related to, you have some kind of expertise. Some of you have very, very in-depth knowledge in this area. Some of you may be working. Some of you are already, researcher in this area of research. So it would be really great like I'm sharing this information with all of you. And for those of you who are in fact working in the allied areas of tribology and other related areas, it is indeed, I will not give you a complete technical know-how kind, but rather I would like to highlight some of the developments that have taken place, as well as I would like to also highlight how we have actually made some contributions in this area for the past 10 years in total. But roughly, of course, as our friend has already mentioned, the work has been continuing for quite long in the area of the fluid film bearings. So this is the title of the presentation, which is kind of hydrodynamics, fluid film bearings, and so on, partial slip texture, surface porous layer configuration. So I would like to acknowledge my collaborators in this area of research from University Technology Petronas in Malaysia, wherein I worked during the period of 2010 to 2016. We received a number of grants, and the different grants enabled us to pursue the research in these areas. And then we could actually consolidate our work, publish them, and then look forward to continuing the work in the same direction. So even after actually coming back in 2016, I was trying to make some contributions in this area in collaboration with my colleagues at University Technology Petronas in Malaysia. And thanks to all our friends, collaborators, and colleagues who are indeed of great support to us, without which the work could not have been done. Even I would like to thank all my colleagues at SRM, friends at other universities as well. So with this brief introduction, I would like to proceed. And before I would like to proceed, I wanted to highlight that, yeah, I want to make the presentation in three parts. The first part is on the surface layer, porous layer configuration. What exactly is that and how did we incorporate that in the bearing? That is one area where we got a grant as well. So surface layer, porous layer. I indeed, in fact, made a presentation on this in the earlier workshop from our friends in GITAM. So the second part of the presentation I would like to make in the area of the partial slip texture, I would like to put in quote. That's the key phrase that we have been using for quite long. So the second part of the presentation, again, in partial slip texture. The last and final part of the presentation, I want to make it in the squeeze film bearings, but again, pertaining to the surface layer and porous layer. I would like to also highlight about the effect of slip and texture, but of course, the results are not there. The reason, I would like to highlight that part as well. So the first two parts are indeed on the hydrodynamic bearings, and the last part is on the squeeze film bearings. But before I would like to start my presentation into dividing into these parts, I would also like to highlight some kind of our directions, ongoing directions on the current research trends. I would like to highlight some of them. Maybe the slide that is over here is actually what you see is about the modeling of the crankshaft main bearings. And this area is of great interest for us, but unfortunately we had to make some entry into this. The reason being that the so-called journal bearings and all, the load is actually acting in the one particular direction. And whereas when we come to these kind of dynamically loaded bearings, such as the engine bearings or main bearings of the crankshaft and so on, we have a kind of a dynamically loaded bearing, wherein the load itself is actually not constant in magnitude direction. So that is in fact very unique, in the sense that we will be able to actually solve, analyze problems in the bearings which have a kind of a dynamic load which is not static in the direction and magnitude, but it is dynamic. So the angle is varying, the magnitude is varying, and so on and so forth. So for example, typically for these kind of engine bearings, we calculate the load cycle for two revolutions of the crankshaft, which is equal to 0 to 720 degrees variation. So, and then it repeats itself periodically. Now here I'm talking about the Newtonian, non-Newtonian fluids and all that. We are also interested to see how these, the partial slip the texture configurations and the locations in these kind of bearings, how we can actually have some kind of enhancement in the engine bearing performance. So when I say the enhancement in the engine bearing performance, fundamentally it is we would like to have a higher value of the minimum film thickness. So as I mentioned just now, when we talk about the 0 to 720 degree cycle for the load variations and all, we will also have the corresponding minimum film thickness variations. We will also have the corresponding load capacities or coefficient of friction, and then subsequently the power loss and so on and so forth. But fundamentally, the minimum film thickness is a very important parameter, as in the engine bearings, we don't want to have the kind of metal-to-metal contact. So the whole idea is either you change the lubricant or you modify the surface in such a way that probably you can, of course, changing the lubricant in the sense, the one very important parameter now the companies are going into, the automobile bearing manufacturer, or you can say the lubricant manufacturers, is that at any cost, the friction needs to be minimized. So when we say the friction needs to be minimized, then they are going into thinner and thinner lubricants as well as smaller and smaller clearance. So that's a major challenge for these bearing manufacturers as well as the engine manufacturer. I mean, engine manufacturers and the lubricant manufacturers. So the point here is that apart from modifying the lubricant or even the are there any ways and means of modifying these bearing surfaces using the slip texture configurations or so on and so forth? Thereby, we can get a higher value of the minimum film thickness. That is one objective. But there are papers that are published in this area of research in the area of the dynamically loaded engine bearings with texturing. So the work is already undergoing. So those of you who are interested, of course, can possibly go through those papers which are published in the literature. That can actually provide great insights into this area of research. I have written down some of the names here. Actually, it is actually our colleague, Professor Dr. Harish Hirani, is one of the pioneers. The part of his PhD work he has done in this area of the dynamically loaded bearings, incorporating the various analytical methods and simulation and so on. But fundamentally, we are actually referring to the work of Professor John Booker from the Cornell University way back in 1965, which he has published in the Journal of Basic Engineering Transactions of ASME. But subsequently, of course, Professor Booker has done pioneering work in this particular area. He has produced more and more intense numerical model simulation to understand the dynamically loaded behavior. But fundamentally, we are more interested into the basic contribution that is actually the mobility method from the Professor Booker. And regarding this work, actually, there was a kind of interest we have with working with Professor Georgi Savithy also through the grants that he has received. So this is still stimulating for us. But before I go to the next slide, I would like to say that although there has been great impact in the kind of electric vehicle technology, tribology of the electric vehicles, of course, we don't have these kind of engine bearings here, which, unless and until it is hybrid. But anyway, so in spite of the great impacts of the moving towards electric vehicles and all, the area of the, of course, solving these kind of dynamically loaded configurations and applying this slip texture, analyzing the bearing configuration is itself very, very interesting to us. The second work, which is actually very close also to us, is the thermohydrodynamic analysis. And again, incorporating the texture, it has been very widely done by Professor Michel Filon and group in University of Paris in France. And currently, one of our Chinese colleagues working for PhD in the University of Paris with Professor Michel Filon's group has also done the work on the incorporating the slip on the thermohydrodynamic behavior of the journal bearings. And they have come up with quite a number of publications in this area. So Of course, sleep texture is not like it's applicable for all configurations of the loading and all that, which we call it as the eccentricity ratio. But even for the lightly loaded cases where we say it is extremely useful, it is really important to see the influence of the temperature variations and subsequently determine to see the temperature effects and subsequently the viscosity variations in the clearance space. So one of the works that we have done in the non-Newtonian, the shear thinning fluid, we could see that the shear thinning has got a good improvement under the effect of sleep as compared to the shear thickening. So kind of we understand that viscosity variations do have a significant impact. But again, viscosity variations are more in the sense that the temperature is higher at the, you can say that at the 180 degree near the zone of the from the line of center as compared to the inlet zone, which is what we are interested in providing the configuration of sleep and texture. So again, this is another area of research which is we are looking into it with the collaborations. And then there is the third area is actually the EHL problems with the Navier sleep and the partial sleep conditions and all that. We have collaborations with our colleagues from, again, University of Technology, Petronas, a different group working in the area of ionic liquids and more interested in tribology of ionic liquids, EHL effects and all that. And so again, I would like to say that we have great interest in, because currently I'm working in the area of hydrodynamic lubrication. But again, the emphasis is more and more on the all regimes of lubrication, mixed, elasto-hydrodynamic and the full film or the thick film lubrication, thin film lubrication, which is actually around between the mixer and elasto-hydrodynamic kind. So these are the different areas of regimes of lubrication where we would like to see the impact of the partial slip texture geometry in the bearings in different regimes of lubrication. Professor Wang Long Li has actually is a pioneer in this area of research and in the area of slip, in the area of lubricant rheology, and even in the EHL as well as hydrodynamics. So he has actually published some papers model into the modeling of these, incorporating the slip effects in different regimes of lubrication, considering the lubricant rheology. Lubricant rheology is, if it is a Newtonian, it's a fundamental model, but if you want to incorporate even complicated models, it can be non-Newtonian. There are many, many models available in non-Newtonian fluids which can be worked upon, and then the corresponding characteristics of these non-Newtonian fluids can be understood under these different applications. So this is another area of interest for us. Yes, our collaborators do have some interest in this as well, in the tribology with ionic liquids. So EHL is another area that we are also very much looking forward to. And again, this is the thin film lubrication and this is the paper I have written, which is actually we are jointly working with our Chinese colleagues. Again, Professor Wang Long Li from Taiwan, he has actually pioneered this area of research and published some articles. So this is another area, which is again the thin film lubrication, electric double layer effects and all that. Thin film lubrication is one area where Professor Jian Bin Lu from the Tsinghua is actually the director of research in the tribology laboratory in Tsinghua, also the one of the president of the Chinese Tribology Society. He has actually made some immense contribution in this particular area of research, that is in the thin film lubrication. So it is, they have introduced different concepts of how the layers of the lubricant will be, and then proceeded with analyzing these kind of lubricant layers and their influence on the behavior of the bearings and so on. So we do have some kind of interest in this area, as our work, which I'm going to also explain, falls very closely in this line, and my collaborators, Professor Fazil and Professor Nina, Professor Gosling is also the student and associate professor currently at Tsinghua, the student of Professor Jian Lin, and they are actually also pioneers in the tribological modeling and experimentations of the different effects of thin film duplication, or even the tribological studies in the bearing configurations and so on. So this is another paper. I would like to state one point here. Recently, we have interactions, and we had keynote lectures from Professor Tomoko Hirayama from Kyoto University, Japan, and Professor Yoshinori Sawai from Kyushu in Japan, and even the Professor Daniel, who is also pioneer in the head of the tribology in Imperial College and pioneer in virtual tribology simulations and so on, numerical simulations in tribology. Fundamentally, as I said, from Japanese professors, Professor Tomoko Hirayama and Professor Yoshinori, of course, they are working in different areas. Professor Yoshinori Sawai is working in biotribology. Professor Hirayama is also a pioneer in modeling in the different regimes of lubrication. Fundamentally, there is one aspect that everybody is trying to highlight here is that they are trying to see the effect of adsorbent layers. They are trying to see the effect of adsorbent layers in the using the experimental techniques. They wanted, I mean, they are actually looking into the measurement of the properties of these adsorbent layers. And after having obtained these kind of layers on the surfaces and then undertaking the tribological studies with these layers of adsorbent layers on the surfaces, and they are actually identifying the enhancement in the tribological properties of coefficient of friction reduction and so on and so forth. So I wanted to say that although the 20 years back when I was looking into the effect of slip, of course texture is has been done in a very, very large scale. Exponential contribution by researchers all around the world has been made into this area of texturing. But when you talk about the slip, when I look at 20 years back and now, I could see that number of researchers have come up with generating the surfaces with slip, and then they are conducting the experimental studies, and they are able to ascertain the whether it is enhancement or deterioration, whatever it is, under the different operating conditions on the bearing performance and all that. So nowadays researchers, they could generate the surfaces with slip, they conduct the experiments and ascertain the performance characteristics. Similarly, then Professor John Tichy and other researchers way back 20 years ago, Professor Wang Long Lee, they generated models of these thin film adsorbent layers or so on and so forth 20 years ago. But currently you could see that, as I am explaining to you, that more and more researchers now are able to generate adsorbent layers, characterize them, and then undertake experimentation and testing and to see the effect of the tribological characteristics with these adsorbent layer surfaces. So there is definitely the great leap in the research outcomes in terms of making these kind of surfaces, in terms of making them feasible and understanding the experimental findings, the real experimental findings with these surfaces. So one could really ascertain the behavior of the concepts that we are actually talking about, like, for example, slip or even the adsorbent layer and so on and so forth. So that is one thing I just wanted to highlight. And although my study in particular is more limited to the modeling, but we are also trying to take a close look onto the developments in these experimental directions and then try to, the focus is on about providing more and more applicable models which are actually falling close to the experimental observations. So that is one objective of our research. Now, this is some of the recent works which I have actually were going to publish in the MIT AC 2020, but unfortunately, because of this the pandemic situation, this is being postponed to next year in July 5 to 7 in Langkawi, Malaysia, and the idea is to have the physical conference. So, I mean, we are missing it, of course, indeed, in 2020, that meeting people. But of course, we have got a new normal in terms of the webinars, which is indeed again making us very close in spite of the physical distance. So this is one conference where we are actually trying to collaborate. This work is in collaboration with the Professor Gasho, who himself is again their group. He's the editor of the Industrial Lubrication Tribology, editor in chief, and then they have a group working in the area of the generation of the textured surfaces and characterization and the testing of the textured surfaces, tribological testing and analysis. So they are both into manufacturing as well as tribological testing. So there is one model, analytical model, that we are actually trying to look into this, which is irrespective of the kind of configuration that we can generate using the manufacturing techniques, whether it can be elliptical groove, triangular, or different trapezoidal recess or textured configuration. So we are trying to ascertain and see how these, in fact, these different configurations are going to influence the tribological characteristics, or more important, you can say that the lubrication characteristics of the bearings. So the one of the key issues here is that I would like to discuss later, in fact, but we have what is called the narrow groove theory, or NGT, which we have proposed for these kind of the textured configurations, and that has been that we have been applying with quite successfully, because we have eliminated working upon numerically, or simulating each groove configuration. Rather, we have a unified model for the kind of groove configuration, for any kind of groove configuration. So that is actually the narrow groove theory, which I will explain again. But what we are, the limitation that we had in the earlier narrow groove theory is that the groove depth was constant. So obviously the focus here is to have a kind of a model, again, a unified model for a non-uniform depth of the groove configuration or the texture configuration. So for example, the elliptical or triangular or trapezoidal type of configurations, which we are actually showing here, they have the kind of a non-uniform texture depth. And we wanted to have some kind of a uniform model. Irrespective of this, the mathematical model will actually solve taking into the respective profiles, and then it can solve. We will be able to obtain the lubrication characteristics of the bearing configuration. So that was the objective, and we are still working on that. And So it is not completely mathematical approach, but rather we have to resort to some kind of a heuristic approach as well. So that work is also actually is done. We are trying to hone up, and then we have to still publish this work as well, and present this work in the upcoming July 5 to 7 in 2021 in Langkawi Island in Malaysia. So this is about the ongoing work. So let me come back to the first part of the presentation now. The first part of the presentation, as I have mentioned, is all about the surface layer, porous layer configuration, the slider in general bearing. So what is the surface? What is all this basically? The layered configuration, as I mentioned just now, I was referring to the work, experimental works of Professor Tomoko Hirayama and Professor Yoshinori Sawai in Japan. And there is indeed a lot of emphasis currently with researchers in terms of trying to understand the adsorbent layers. Usually the adsorbent layers are having the thickness of the nanometers. But if we are referring to the thin film lubrication, which itself is of the hundreds of nanometers, then the adsorbent layers do have a significant impact. But if we are referring to the conventional hydrodynamic lubrications with much higher than the micron, to the order of the micron thickness of the clearance space, then probably these
the absorbent layers may not have a significant impact because of their limitation in the thickness to the order of nanometers. So these are the layers which are absorbent on the surfaces. Researchers are able to generate surfaces with these absorbent layers, maybe from the lubricant additives or maybe with the other means and so on. But we are technically not looking into that part, but rather we are trying to understand and analyze what kind of effect will these absorbent layers are going to provide, right? So as I was actually telling you, way back in 2002 or whatever, maybe beyond that, Professor John Tichy, he has come up with a number of models. Professor Wang Long Li himself has come up with extensions of the Professor John Tichy's models are similar models. And Dr. Guillermo Moras Astrogel from SKF and currently the professor, visiting professor in Imperial College, they have also done some work in these absorbent layer combinations. So primarily, what we are trying to say here is that the effect of the absorbent layer, we are actually considering it as a, referring to the works of the earlier researchers like Professor Tichy and Professor Wang Long Li, we are trying to model them as a high viscosity layer. Conventional layer has a viscosity mu, dynamic viscosity mu. We can say that the absorbent layer has got a viscosity 10 times higher or whatever, right? And or we can model them as the porous layer which is absorbent to the surface, right? Or it can be an elastic layer which can be absorbent to the surface. So these are normally the, these are the normal ways by which researchers have tried to understand consider the effect of the physical absorbent layers on the surfaces. So we have also taken a cue from those researchers, and what we have done is actually we have tried to understand what would be the case if the absorbent layer is having higher viscosity, or if it can be treated as a porous layer. Then what we have done is previously the researchers like Al Shakhtavi and all, Professor Wang Long Li and all, they have done for a single layer. What we have done is for double layer. So that's only different, but fundamentally the models are the same, right? But that's what it is. Fundamentally the techniques are the same, but I would like to highlight how we have made it different anyway. Now, one of the things that I'm showing it here is the stabilization of journal bearing using two-layer film lubrication, which we published way back in 2012. So while I'm trying to explain to you that the impact of the surface layer or the high viscosity surface layer or the high viscosity absorbent layer, in fact, Professor Andros Zeri in US, he has actually published a paper of which is, you can say, hypothetical work, because he has come up with an idea of a bearing lubricated with oil and water. The idea here, what he would like to say is that the idea is in fact to reduce the friction. When you say the bearing lubricated with a layer of oil and water, it is in fact hypothetical because you cannot have the two different layers. So, of course, based on that, in fact, Professor Andros Zeri has come up with another paper, which is the floating ring configuration, where the inner clearance is with oil and the outer clearance is with water or whatever. But anyway, the floating ring is entirely, the performance is entirely different as compared to the simple plain journal bearing configuration, because you are having an additional ring in the clearance space. That makes it altogether a different bearing, right? So the analysis or the characteristics are again altogether different. So, but taking the idea of Professor Andros Zeri, and of course it matches very well with the ideas of Professor Tichy and Professor Wang Long Li. The only difference is that they are talking about the absorption layer, while Professor Zeri is talking about a kind of the magnitude of oil and water layers are almost. Can have variation to that clearance space extent, isn't it? To the order of the thickness of the clearance space, which is quite big. Anyway, so taking that idea, And another wonderful thing that he has done is he has in fact produced the results not absolute but in terms of the relative in the sense that he has you can say that the ratio of the two layered performance with the single layer performance, you know? So the load capacity is compared as a ratio, and friction and all are they are also derived. So taking this as a motivation, we have done the work of extending the load capacity to the bearing stability, which is again a different aspect altogether. But we got some the idea of how we can extend the work of this two-layered configuration and then produce the stability characteristics and then normalize the stability characteristics in terms of the base fluid configuration and so on. That I will discuss. And then we are talking about, as I just mentioned, most of the work was with the porous, single porous layer. What we have done here is a double porous layer. In the double porous layer, obviously, you have the two different layers of different thicknesses and different permeability. But one of the very interesting configurations which we have obtained is where should the porous layer be? Should the porous layer be above the kind of a, you know, close to the lubricant or close to the bearing surface? Now, in this regard, we have actually come up with, we have found out another paper which is actually saying that if you have a kind of a, you know, complete permeability, means the porous layer is ineffective, but of course you can call it as a porous layer, but it is the permeability is so open, is so high that you can treat it as a normal layer, right? So we have found out a paper where you can generate a porous layer which is almost as good as any normal layer of film, and then you can have a very low permeability porous layer, which is in fact low permeability in the sense it tries to resist the fluid flow. Okay, so when we say then what we have done is we have done the computation of taking the layer which resists the flow close to the lubricant and the layer which does not resist the flow like a kind of a backing layer. So this is what we have actually contributed, and we try to analyze that the backing layer can be something like a very normal layer. It is a porous, but the permeability can be high, so that it is acting as a simple layer of lubricant. But the topping layer should be the one which decides the bearing performance characteristics, because if you make the topping layer to be a porous in the sense that with very low permeability, that means it doesn't allow the lubricant to flow that easily, it resists the flow of the fluid, then the bearing performance characteristics are going to be significantly enhanced. So that is what we made some contribution. And then of course the subsequent papers are more or less a combination of these ideas only. So I don't want to discuss more into that. So coming back to the stabilization of the general bearing using the two-layered film unification, I don't want to go into the details of the mathematics of the stabilization and all that, but referring to this figure, what I want to say here is that there are two layers. So falling back to the idea of Professor and Rosary, what he says is that the large amount of friction in the bearings can be reduced by opting for a very low viscous fluids. But again, a low viscous fluid is obviously as not useful because it cannot generate the load capacities. So that is why he says we want to reduce the friction, we want to improve the load capacity, and that is why a hypothetical combination of the oil and water has been analyzed. So, and wherein he could show that the friction is reduced and the load capacity is regained. That is the whole idea. But mathematically speaking, this is in line, intact with what the models of the adsorbent layers by Professor Tichy and Professor Banglong have done. Right, so this is what it is. I don't want to go into the detail, but then what we have done is we have actually analyzed it with the various with the low viscous
layer water close to the journal or water close to the bearing, that is a low viscous fluid close to the journal, low viscous fluid close to the bearing, and so on. And then we have tried to analyze the performance characteristics and the stability characteristics and so on. So I don't want to go into the details, but what I want to highlight here is that everything that we are doing is actually starting from the fundamental governing equation. So we have the simplest governing equation is the momentum equation. Sorry. So the simplest governing equation is the momentum equation, which we call the Newtonian momentum equation. And then there we have some set of boundary conditions. So what we do is we integrate this moment, we integrate the governing equations with the boundary condition. We integrate it twice to get the velocity profile, and we again integrate the, I mean, we have some sort of additional conditions of shear stress at the interface and so on and so forth. But fundamentally, when we have the continuity equation, we integrate the velocity across the film thickness. So when we do that, we get a continuity equation, which we call the first order Reynolds equation. So we do solve the first order Reynolds equation with the pressure boundary conditions, and we get what is called the pressure profile. And of course, the dynamics part is different. Again, I don't want to tell more into that, but what I want to say here is that the dynamic analysis is exactly what we are following from the pioneering work by the Professor Lund, which he has published way back in 1978, ASME conference paper. In fact, that is the industry benchmark for the, even till today. I can say that even 40 plus years, but that is the industry benchmark even till today in the rotating equipment industries or and so on, right? Process plants or the power plant or any kind of the plant which has these huge rotating equipment operated and maintained by the General Electric. These the work of the pioneering work of Professor Lund on the understanding of the rotor bearing characteristics is still intact. So that is what exactly we are trying to follow. Whatever has been given by Professor Lund in terms of understanding the bearing behavior, that is the same which we are actually following. But only difference is all the analysis that we are doing is by using the long bearing approximation. And I would also like to highlight the pioneering contribution by in the textbook of rotor dynamics by Professor Gates Rao, who passed away recently. And he has actually produced the short bearing approximation model based on the Lund's infinitesimal perturbation model for the two dimensional bearing configuration. So that is in fact another kind of motivation. Our long bearing model, Professor J.S. Rao has given the short bearing model, we have given long bearing model, but both of them are actually in line with the perturbation technique that is provided by the Professor Lund. Actually, that paper in ASME, Journal of Basic Engineering, by Lund and Thompson, but we are still actually more popularly calling it as the Professor Lund's the immense contribution to the bearing analysis. Anyway, so that was all about it. So finally, what I wanted to say here is that I don't want to go into all the details because they are very highly relevant for us here at this stage. But kind of we could see that we are trying to generate the two configurations, the configuration one, configuration two, basically. As I said previously, that water close to the journal is one configuration, water close to the bearing is one configuration, the remaining is filled by the oil. So that is the configurations. And the one very interesting result, as you could see here, is for example, beta is equal to 10. Beta is actually the viscosity ratio. So if you take base fluid as the water, oil you can treat it as high viscosity fluid, and beta is actually saying that the viscosity of the oil is 10 times the viscosity of the water. In the second case, we are trying to say that the viscosity of the oil is 100 times the viscosity of the water. So in both the cases, we could see that some sort of a peak is obtained here, beta is equal to 10 and beta is equal to 100 for this CW. CW is actually the coefficient of threshold speed, and we could see that for beta is equal to 10, it is close to gamma is 0.2. Similarly, it is going back to gamma 0.1 for 100. What is exactly gamma is? We are trying to say that if the high viscosity layer, which is close to the bearing, is actually 80% thick, 80% of the clearance space, then that is what we are trying to say, that it is going to give the enhancement in the threshold speed of this order. But anyway, so fundamentally what we could prove is that by having this kind of a hypothetical configuration, we could get a huge improvement in the threshold speed, which is, threshold speed is ideally the speed at which you can operate these turbo machinery very safely, right? So anyway, so this is all about it. So some results are there, but practically it is not possible, as I mentioned already, because this is a hypothetical model, because we cannot have a combination of two different layers in the bearings. Anyway, so coming back to the second work, this is the work that I'm trying to explain to you, that the general bearing, so we are now calling it as the porous layer 1, then porous layer 2, and so on. So what I mentioned previously is, I mean, this is anyway double layer because we have two different layers, but what I highlighted here, based on one of the works in the literature review, which was published in the Journal of Applied Mechanics, Transactions of ACME, that it is extremely difficult, in fact, to generate these kind of layers. It's obviously, I mean, that of course the experimentalists can tell us more clearly, but what we are trying to say is that the porous layer 1, which is a backing layer to the bearing, it can be like a normal layer. It is a porous, it is treated as a porous, but it can be as good as a normal layer with high permeability. High permeability means less resistance to the flow. But the topping layer is extremely important, which decides the performance characteristics. So if you can generate a topping layer, which is very, very porous, in the sense that very low permeability, means the fluid cannot permeate, So then there is significant enhancement in the bearing performance characteristics. So that is what we are trying to call it. And that is what we are trying to say is a surface porous layer configuration. So a surface layer means the layer 1, which you can call it as good as a surface layer, although it is a porous layer with high permeability. You can as good as call it as a surface layer, but the topping layer, which is the region 2, should be the layer which should resist the flow of the fluid, which should not allow the fluid to permeate. And then we could show that there is a significant impact. See, the whole idea is that generation of the surfaces is one thing, characterizing them is one thing, and then, but of course, you know, you need to have these layers sustained in the bearings. They obviously, there is metal to metal contact only during the starting and stopping, but if these kind of layers, especially under thin film condition, not necessary that I'm showing the example of the bearings here, but it can be even for the MEMS applications or even the slider bearing applications where the film thicknesses are very thin. The thin film lubrication theory is very much applicable there. And then if these layers can be sustained, then there is a significant amount of improvement in the performance characteristics of those applications. That is the whole idea. And again, I don't want to go into the details here, but what I would like to say is that previously, again, I have showed you the momentum equations. Here we have the momentum equations. For the porous layer, we have what is called the Brinkmann equations. And the for the fluid layer, we have used the coupled stress film. So that is why we have used the momentum equation, which is based on the Stokes coupled stress theory. And then we have the simple governing Newtonian momentum equation for the, if the lubricant is considered to be Newtonian. And then we have the different layers. So we have the different boundary conditions. We have the different conditions in the interfaces. We need to incorporate all of them. And then when we do the integration of these momentum equations with these boundary conditions and the interface conditions, we get what is called the Rossley profiles. And as I mentioned, integration of the velocity profiles across the thickness, we get what is called the continuity equation, which we call it as the first order Lennard's equation. Also, every time since we are modifying the equation, we call it as a modified Lennard's equation, and then which is actually an equation in terms of the pressure gradient, and then we integrate it across the extent of the film using the pressure boundary conditions, we get the pressure profile. And similarly, the shear stress is obtained because we have the velocity profile with the gradient of the velocity profile. We will give us the shear stress and integration of the shear stress, we get the friction force and the ratio of the friction force to the load capacity. Integration of the pressure profile, we get the load capacity. So ratio of the friction force to the load capacity will give us what is called the coefficient of friction. So I don't want to go into the details because much of the work is in fact in alignment with the pioneering contribution by Professor Wang Long Li. So the structure of the analysis is very much retained, except that the idea of the surface layer and the porous layer have been incorporated. So Professor Al Sharkawi from Egypt also has contributed in this. So these are some of the pioneering contributions which we have referred, and then we have made into these papers trying to highlight the effect. So you could see in fact that 1, 2, 3, 4, 7 and all that. So by having these kind of layers with different thicknesses, different permeabilities, right? K is a factor of permeability, delta is a non-dimensional thickness. So most of the analysis that we do here is basically non-dimensional. So the numbers that you see are non-dimensional. So they do not represent the exact values, but the non-dimensional characteristics provide us some kind of understanding on the fundamental behavior or the enhancement of the load capacity or reduction in the coefficient of friction and so on. So they are all into that. So we could see that, yeah, so with increase in eccentricity ratio of the bearing, then we could see that the load capacity is also significantly improved. So these are all the analysis. So I don't want to discuss, CF is referring to the coefficient of friction. We could get for the configuration 7, when we got enhancement of the load capacity, we could also get reduction in the coefficient of friction. So I don't want to discuss more into that. So anyway, so the subsequent papers are more or less falling onto the similar thing. So let me not spend time. I apologize and I'd like to move away from them. Yeah, so something like a conclusion we have said is actually the major contribution is the surface layer contribution is one of the key contributions we have made in this area. We have tried to show that the topping layer is extremely important because if the topping layer can stop the flow of the fluid, can resist the flow of the fluid, and thereby the immense improvement in the bearing performance can be obtained. So without actually having to produce the entire layer of the characteristics of the topping layer, you can actually produce a backup layer, which is very, very normal. But the topping layer can be probably made with in that order so that the bearing enhancement can be obtained. So that is actually the conclusion from this. So I want to move into the next section of my presentation. I don't want to take much of the time as well, but rather, you know, another 15 minutes, 20 minutes, I would like to wind up my presentation by highlighting some of the works that we have done. And so this is again, I would like to briefly, and those of you, if you are in my previous presentations, probably you are very well aware of the work that we have carried out. But for the benefit of some of our friends, the new participant friends, maybe I would like to briefly highlight that this is the work that is actually, I have put in quote, that is what is called the partial slip texture. So the idea here is that the actually way back in 2008, I started looking back what was to be done, and then in the area of general bearings and all that, then I found that since 2000, some unique papers that have started coming out. One of them is the effect of slip in the bearings. Right. So then Professor Salant and his master student, Professor Hugh Spikes, he has published one paper, critical shear stress, using the critical shear stress theory in the slip for the slip configuration. Professor Salant, Richard Salant, and his student, master student, they have come up with the effect of slip using the Navier slip model. And our Chinese colleagues, they have even come up with the critical shear stress model. And they have started highlighting the, again, contribution of slip in the performance characteristics and so on. So these were some of the papers which started appearing. And in 2008, I have done a conventional bearing stability model with the slip. Of course, we got some results and that paper was published. So again, subsequently, I was actually looking at working on these models. So although I did not contribute in the direction of critical shear stress model for the slip, what we have taken is we have taken the Navier slip condition. Since there are already some papers in the direction and taking the motivation from our colleagues in Tsinghua, who have done some work in the area of theoretical modeling in the slider and general bearing configurations. So the same slider and bearing configurations by our colleagues in Tsinghua, I have actually thought of working for the slip configuration. And we have used the Navier slip model, Navier slip model, and we have actually published some work. And the reviewers has commented saying that the slip has been actually done extensively. So what is actually the reason for which the manuscript should be accepted? And that probably motivated us to look beyond. And I wanted to again say that during the same time as early 2000, what I mentioned about the slip configuration research started coming up. The texture configuration research also started coming up in the early 2000. It's not that texture is something new. Even people have started working on the roughness textures way back in 1960s. So texture is not new, although slip was new at that time. The reason why people have started taking note is actually, again, the pioneering contribution by Professor Tonder, who said that inlet roughness or inlet texture is actually the one that is required for the bearings which are parallel, or you can say that low load capacity bearings, or you can say that the bearings which are used under MEMS applications, which are ideally for the low load applications. So this inlet texture, that made a significant impact. And then the colleagues, the Imperial College and Professor Hugh Spikes and the groups, so they also started working on how these texture configurations at the inlet do work and what kind of phenomena of cavitation will happen and so on and so forth. So then finally, anyway, the point here is that the paper which I mentioned, again, we revised it incorporating one cell consisting of a slip region and a texture region, which we call it as a recess region. So cell is something like, you know, it's a cell is a mixture of a land and a recess, a land with a slip and the recess with the texture. So, I mean, recess is nothing but a texture, right? So this is actually the reason why we are actually calling it as the partial slip texture analysis, and the configuration is named after the partial slip texture bearing. Many of our Chinese colleagues have done immense contribution in this particular area of research. At that time, I'm referring at the time of 2010 and around 2012. And the reason why I'm trying to say is that both the slip and the texture, they are applicable for parallel configurations or the low load capacity configuration. They are applicable for MEMS configuration. In fact, the slip has started taking its advances in the MEMS application, where they are trying to understand the behavior of the flow of the fluids with the MEMS surfaces having the slip effect. So the idea here is that if you have a slip, the resistance to the flow is reduced. When you have a resistance to the flow reduced, then of course the flow is going to be predominant. And then when the analysis was taken to the bearing, what the researchers like Professor Hughes have reported, or even other researchers like Professor Salang and Cook have reported, is that they are trying to say that full slip means slip is there on both the bearing and the journal. Partial slip means they have identified that slip is not beneficial on the journal, so put it on the bearing. That is what partial slip. Even partial slip is not found to be beneficial, so they have come to the idea of quarter slip. Quarter slip means the slip is not entirely on the bearing surface, but to some extent of the bearing surface, which is typically the inlet region. Now the same goes with the texture. Predominantly, researchers have started manufacturing bearings with the textures. Textures on the entire surface, as I mentioned just now, it is something not new. But again, the inlet texture, as highlighted by Professor Tonda, is something very, 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 very innovative. And in terms of especially those parallel bearings, if you say parallel bearing, it does not have low capacity. It cannot resist any load. So the so-called parallel bearings, they are able to generate for MEMS applications by incorporating the inlet slip or the inlet texture. So that is why when we said partial slip texture configurations and so on, we started working at the inlet. But later on, a number of researchers have started to show that it is possible at the middle region or at the other regions, and then depending on the eccentricity ratio or other operating parameters, some kind of benefits can be obtained. But then fundamentally, we have stuck to the notion that the partial slip texture has to be applied at the inlet, and that is exactly beneficial for the low load capacity or the parallel bearing configurations only, and not for the other type of configurations. So that is exactly what the motivation was. And then some amount of work was done. And then there is an invitation from Professor Senator I got from Italy. And then we have actually written down the review paper covering the various advances in the partial slip texture, bearing configurations in the slider and journal bearings, and then that was published way back in 2018. And then, yeah, so I would like to quickly go through, not want to discuss more into these, but rather like to say how we have evolved. Well, so this is the 2010 paper I have discussed in detail. I said the one cell, the land with the slip, and the recess of the texture. In fact, sometimes we do something, but we do not understand what we're doing. So this is exactly the same thing that happened with this. When I met my Indonesian friend who completed his PhD in the University of Twente in Netherlands, and he was actually working on the same, and then he has actually reported to me the ideas that he has understood based on reading this work, and then he shared his ideas. It is so surprising that I have actually, it's kind of a re-understanding and relearning. I have unlearned what I have learned, and then I have relearned from him. So many times, thanks to our colleagues for making us to understand what we do. So that made some kind of more impact later in terms of this work. Now, yeah, so some of these results, I don't want to explain more into them, but rather we say that we have the enhanced load capacity and friction. But fundamentally, what I show here is the pressure and the shear stress. So this, all these figures are actually we have replicated from the Chingwa colleagues who have published in the slider and journal bearings. But of course, they did not apply the slip configuration. But fundamentally, the way they have tried to understand, they analyze the problem, we have taken that idea and we have applied it to our slip texture analysis. Right. So this is a review paper. I don't want to go into the details of it. I have already explained that we have made a review highlighting the contributions of the slip and texture. I don't want to go into the details of these, but rather, we have in the review, what we have done is we have done the review of the slip, then second category is texture, the third category is slip texture. We have done for slider bearing, and then the second category is for journal bearing. Then we have done for parallel bearing, we have done for convergent bearing, then we have done for understanding the behavior of the various performance characteristics, like for example, what would be the effect of the eccentricity ratio or the slope parameter for the journal and slider, whatever. And then we have tried to see how the coefficient of sleep or the texture parameters do have an influence on the performance characteristics. We have also done what could be the effect of one-dimensional texture or the two-dimensional texture, what would be the case of a simulation or a model, what would be the case of the cavitation boundary condition or the so many parameters have been taken into consideration and the results have been reported categorically. Now this is another paper. What I wanted to say here is that the single cell concept that we have actually done has been applied to the multi-cell concept. So then that means then, you know, if we have 4 cells or 10 cells or 20 cells or whatever, the cell is consisting of a land with the slip region and the recess with no slip region or a texture. So the single cell concept has been extended to multi-cell concept, and then the paper has been reported. And at the same time, there is another paper actually that was reported in the Tribology International from our friends in France, who has actually done a slip in the recess region and the land does not contain the slip. So what they have said is that the texture portion, they would like to add some the kind of lubricants or some additives or whatever, which can actually deposit on the surface and can create a slip. So that's anyway, again, altogether a different the concept. But what I wanted to say is that they have applied the slip in the recess of the texture region. Anyway, so this is the paper which is later, just come up later, but fundamentally we are following the same concept, which is called the narrow group theory. The fundamental idea behind the narrow group theory, which was actually published way back in 1965 in the Journal of Basic Engineering, Transactions of ASME, by Professor Bohr and Chow, is that they have showed that if the number of grooves do not influence the results, then probably you can consider it as a infinitely large number of grooves, or we can call it as a narrow groove analysis. But fundamentally, what we are doing is that I have showed some kind of a sawtooth profiles earlier in the slide. Basically, we are trying to average them out. So instead of having a kind of a sawtooth profile, we can probably average them out and say that the performance is going to be the same. The reason being that when we conducted for the multiple cells and when we investigated it, we have observed that the number of cells, whether it is 4, 5, 10, 16, 20, they do not have any influence on the result, especially for the long bearing configuration that we are actually working upon. And then similar results were also found out and reported by our friends from the University of Poitiers, France. And then we could understand that these kind of the number of cells do not influence the results. So obviously we can remove that particular parameter. We can have it as a kind of a configuration, which is a combination of the slip texture, whatever, but not taking into account of the number of cells. So that is where the concept of narrow group theory is coming up, which was actually reported by Professor Warren Chow, and that we have incorporated here, which is basically you are averaging out the peaks and valleys. That's the fundamental understanding, right? So again, I don't want to go into the model. And apologies, sir. Okay, I'm so sorry, yes. So yeah, I'm so sorry, yeah. So anyway, so the results are trying to show that the narrow group theory results are exactly in alignment. I mean, they are completely in agreement with the slow parameters of 0.1, 0.3, and 0.5, so on, which are the regions of our interest, right? So I don't want to go into the details. And then this is another paper again. I don't want to discuss much, except that after this, I wanted to say one thing that I have actually reported to you that in 2008, we have published a paper on stability. So load capacity is what is called in bearings a steady state analysis. And the stability is a dynamic analysis where we are trying to understand what is the behavior in terms of its operating stable speeds, right?
Now, one important observation which we have debated in the Beijing WTC, the World Tribal Congress, is also that the configuration of partial slip texture that we have taken for the, at the inlet is producing contrasting results for the load capacity and the stability. The configuration which is giving us enhancement in the load capacity is actually not providing us any enhancement. It is deteriorating the stability. So if I were to suggest as a designer a configuration which can enhance both load capacity and stability, that is where we have found it extremely difficult, right? So probably the reason, if we have to attribute, and I have to actually fall back to the theory by Cameron, what says that the tangential load is one particular, the tangential force is the key parameter which provides instability. It's actually getting higher when we have these kind of partial slip texture configuration. So that tangential force, the steady component is enhancing the load, but the dynamic component is giving us reduction in the stability. So this is one fundamental observation which we are actually understanding. And probably it is really, really getting us difficult to see how this can be alleviated. But one elliptical bearing configuration, of course, these are again the different configuration. I have to say again, the professor Oscar Pinkus, way back in 40s or 50s, they have come up with this different load configuration. And the same has been pioneered by Professor Lund in, Dr. Lund in 1978, and which is in fact followed as the industry benchmark. So when we introduced this partial slip texture, the inlet of these lobe configurations, we could see that the two lobe, that's the configuration B, the two lobe configuration, is actually trying to give us enhancement in the load as well as some improvement in the stability also. I mean, a substantial improvement in the stability. But whereas others, when we have an enhancement in the load, they are not able to provide enhancement in the stability. So these are some of the contrasting results. So ultimately, we could see that the two-lobe bearing configuration, which is actually widely used in industrial equipment, which are being operated to support these heavy rotors, that configuration is in fact helping us to achieve improvement in the load and stability. So that's one of the key, and the results that I've presented are for that only. So anyway, I don't want to discuss the conclusion part, but the last part, I don't want to spend much time, I will wind up in 2 minutes, is about the squeeze film analysis, right? So these are basically squeeze film bearings are, you know, the different applications are there, industrial applications, but rather we are actually trying to work upon the biotribological applications, that is typically for the skeletal joint applications. Of course, our models are not that very complex. Because we are working on the one-dimensional analysis, the models are typically, you can have a 2.5 dimension. So we are only working on the one dimensions, and the depth configuration is pretty uniform, is the same, you know, uniform. So we have worked on the plate configuration and the partial journal bearing configuration. So here I wanted to say two things. The first thing is the so-called the slip texture will not have any benefit in the squeeze film analysis. When we talk about these parallel plate or the partial journal bearing for the knee joint or the hip joint, typically, the analogy is to the knee and the hip joint, these kind of slip or texture will not at all benefit these kind of the skeletal joint bearing applications. The reason being that unlike where we have the shear flow in the normal earlier bearing applications which we have shown, but if we take the squeeze film applications, it is only that the two plates are approaching each other with some velocity, and then having a kind of a slip or a texture is as good as your the MEMS applications, where the resistance is not at all there for the fluid to flow. So simply the fluid is flowing without any resistance. So same happens here in the case of the squeeze film bearings, and then our results indicated that the slip and the texture did not make any improvement. So that is why most of the work that you see are basically the lubricants are non-Newtonian. Obviously, non-Newtonian lubricants, in fact, provide the reduction in the time to for the film to close, or you can say that the load capacity is going to be enhanced with the non-Newtonian. So this is where we have tried to understand and analyze our surface layer and the porous layer configurations. That is what you see typically in these human joint applications. So if these kind of layered configurations, even in the the joint replacements also, if the bearing application, the bearings that are being made, if they can be made with these the layer kind of a porous layer configuration, they will be able to. It's not the porous material. It's the core is not porous, but the layer is actually the porous, which can probably delay the flow of the lubricant to get squeezed out of the bearing configuration, whether it's hip joint, or typically referring to the general bearing partial application, or a knee joint, which is something like parallel plate. So this is one of the contribution, but mathematically, this is again falling back to the same thing that we have discussed earlier. So I don't want to spend time here discussing the same, but the models are more or less the same, except that the shear component is absent in the squeeze film applications, and then we are only taking the time variant squeeze motion into account, and the calculations are being done. Professor Lin from Taiwan is our reference here. Professor Lin has made immense contributions again, like Professor Wang from Taiwan, and then so some of his papers are being referred, and we have followed up the papers, except that the modeling of the porous or the surface layer has been done, and the results have been obtained. So you could see that the differences in the load capacity, you could see they are with the different configuration of the layers and thicknesses of the layers and so on. I think so the conclusion is actually very much there, that slip is not beneficial. You have to go for a kind of a porous layer. If a surface layer is nothing but a porous layer, I mean, it's a high viscosity surface layer, but the coming to the biomedical applications, it is the coatings, the porous layer coatings, which can, if they are sustainable, and they are going to definitely enhance the applications in the biomedical, and the joint replacements can be, the life of the joint replacements can be enhanced. So I would like to, of course, conclude my presentation with great gratitude and the thanks to all my collaborators who have made all this possible, and without them, I would have not probably done many of these works. So thanks to our sponsors, the MOHE for years, and other thanks, and the YUTP grants, and the collaborators, and thank you to all of you. Thank you so much for listening to me very patiently. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. I again apologize that video is not working here. I'm trying to click on this. Yeah, no, it has come now. Okay, thank you. Oh, okay. The issue is there, I think. Okay, so welcome, sir. Any questions?
Participants, you can ask any questions if you have. Very well, VP madam, I think you can speak to Sav now if you have any questions. Sav, you can speak now. Very well, Sav, you can speak now if you have any questions. Hello.
Yeah, I could see my colleague Dr. Jitendra is also here, who is our very active collaborator, and he's also very active researcher in Taiwan. So we had recently the ITRS 2020 as well.
Yes, sir.
We have a lot of support from all of you.
So one of the faculty, Vettilivel, is having some question.
Sir.
So,
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, that layer will be always porous only, sir.
Yeah, actually, yes, sir. So physically, it has to be retained. The way that we are actually trying to calculate mathematically, physically, the properties can be retained. Yes, we can get the results that we are trying to provide in the mathematical point of view. Yeah, it will follow the same results, sir.
Thank you, sir.
There has been significant improvement in the technology, sir, for the past 5 to 10 and so on. So people are actually producing the experimental results using these layered configurations and all this. Tribological results are being obtained, and the encouraging tribological results can probably be considered for bearing simulations too. Yes, sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. That was a nice presentation on hydrodynamic and squeeze film analysis of bearings. I hope this could be a great source of valuable information to all the faculty members and researchers who are doing active research in this field. The presentation highlights about developments in the modeling of partial slip texture configuration analysis in bearings, and it is an excellent illustrative display by Professor TVV Ellen Rao, sir. I thank Professor TVV Ellen Rao, sir, on behalf of Geetham School of Technology, Bangalore campus, and Geetham management. Thank you, sir. Thank you with us for your valuable time. I thank all the participants for your active participation. I request all of you to join at the second session, which starts at 11:30 a.m. Thank you all. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for your kind support and encouragement. It is indeed an honor always to be on this webinar platform, sir. Thank you to all the participants for listening to us patiently.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.